ladies and gentlemen. I also have to start with saying that I'm very grateful to the organizers to bring me to Kanpur, especially Dr. Gurao and Dr. Shashank, who are the organizer of this workshop. And I'm always very happy to be in India, which is my birth country. I was born in Simla. And lived there for until the age of six. So I started with having here 6 years. Yesterday you learned a lot about structure and a little bit about so-called microstructure, which is beyond the structure. And since I assume there are many of you who are interested not only in the structure of materials, but also in what is happening if you are using a specific material for application, then you are also interested about what kind of properties the material has, and the properties usually are determined, as it was mentioned yesterday already, by many other aspects than only the basic crystal structure, although the crystal structure is absolutely decisive for the properties, but there are more beyond the crystal structure which add to the properties. We know all very well that, for example, FCC crystals, face-centered cubic crystals, deform relatively easily, but BCC materials, body-centered cubic, they are somewhat more difficult to deform. For example, stainless steel is an excellent material for making kitchen utensils or boilers because it will not corrode, but you cannot make a good knife or a good forging equipment out of stainless steel because it is soft, like almost soft like copper. But BCC iron is very bad for corrosion properties. It is very apt to get corroded, but still it is used for making a ship, and you have to think about how to protect it for against corrosion, because BCC iron and its alloys are the best structural materials. Not talking about the magnetic properties, BCC is ferromagnetic, FCC, stainless steel, is not ferromagnetic. So it is not the property of the iron atom which produces the magnetism, but the crystal structure. Now, line profile analysis is actually a niche in characterizing material properties, and this has a very simple reason. We human beings are used to pictures and images, and we are always happy if we can see something as a picture or an image that has been also utilized or exploited by the information technologists. They love to make icons so that you don't have to think, you don't have to read, but you just look at the image, the icon, and immediately you know what it is about. And if you have the chance to see the microstructure, you have the chance to see something which is inside the material, then you are very happy. And what are these methods? These are the imaging methods, which is normal metallography, optical metallography, and all the electron microscopy methods, transmission electron microscopy, scanning electron microscopy, etc. So these methods have been developed to an extremely high level. Today, all the research equipment producers are very lucrative business, very lucrative companies. They can sell tremendous, fantastic electron microscopes, transmission, scanning, all sorts of things. And no doubt, these equipment are the best to get the structure of materials. Now, diffraction, however, can tell you different aspects of the microstructure, and it is sometimes very useful to combine these imaging techniques with other methods. You have so many other methods. For example, you can measure the electrical resistivity, which nowadays is not so popular, but there was an age when it was very popular. That tells you a lot about the microstructure, because the electrons are scattered on the lattice defects. Or you can measure the magnetic properties. A transmission electron micrograph will not tell you anything about the magnetic properties. So there are other methods to characterize the microstructure. And it turns out that diffraction is also a very useful tool. So line profile analysis, as it is called today, is one of these auxiliary methods next to imaging, which can tell you quite a lot. And if you combine this with the imaging techniques, then you can understand much more about what the microstructure in your structural material is. The method is very old. It started in 1923. When a metallurgist, a material scientist, who was working for the railway company in southern Germany, now somewhere around the city called Stuttgart, has done X-ray diffraction patterns, has taken X-ray diffraction patterns of railway rails. And he was very surprised that although no doubt the surface was absolutely damaged or deformed to an extent, whatever you can imagine, he still saw sharp peaks. He thought that the material would have become absolutely amorphous. But instead of that, it was perfectly crystalline. There was a slight difference between the annealed iron peak shape and the one which he measured on the rail surface. There was a slight broadening. And that was the dawn of line profile analysis. So it is a very old technique. And it has gone through many humps, many setbacks at the beginning, mainly because of poor quality of equipment. And the interpretation was also a problem. People didn't know how to interpret this broadening. And at that time, there was no imaging except metallography. Later, in the early 40s, people have discovered, well, not there were two people. Berg and Barrett, who discovered the Berg-Barrett method. Perhaps you haven't heard about it today because it has absolutely gone out of fashion. But the Berg-Barrett is the X-ray diffraction alternative, or the same in X-ray, the same with X-rays, what you do in a transmission electron microscope. It shows you the image of the defects in principle, exactly in the same way, the principles of a Berg-Barrett micrograph is exactly the same as what you use when you make a TEM micrograph. Exactly the same. The problem with the Berg-Barrett photograph, because you only get one stationary image. The Berg-Barrett, in the Berg-Barrett, you see bunches of defects. And the reason for this is that the contrast of images produced by X-rays is about two or three orders of magnitude wider than the contrast what is produced by electrons. And the simple reason for that is that the interaction of X-rays, which are photons, with matter, is by two or three orders of magnitude weaker than the interaction of electrons with matter. Electrons with matter interact by the Coulomb force, which is the strongest force we have in nature, whereas photons interact it is a wave interacting with matter, which is much, much weaker, two or three orders of magnitude. This we learn in school. Light is almost not interacting with matter, or the interaction is so weak. Now, this property, this fundamental difference in the strength of interaction with matter, is also the advantage of X-rays in contrast to electrons. Electrons interact terribly strongly, through the Coulomb force, and therefore see only short distances in the material. Whereas X-rays, which are photons, they interact weakly, and they are sensitive to long-range features in the material. The long-range features cause this interaction difference causes also that the contrast, the imaging contrast of X-rays is so wide. Well, I shouldn't talk in rebuses, in hidden terms. I'm thinking of dislocations, which are the most profound lattice defect which form the properties of materials. The dislocation contrast in an X-ray image is wide over several thousand angstroms, whereas in the TEM, the contrast is very narrow. That is the reason why in a TEM, you can see individual dislocations. But in a Berg-Barrett topogram, you can only see bunches of dislocations, large bunches where there are thousands of dislocations. But you can see them. So Okay, so Bergbaret was a very good method which was used in the end of the 30s or the beginning of the 40s, but then with PEM it disappeared. So nowadays you don't even know what it is. Well, PEM then, perhaps you know that transmission electron microscopy started, well, it started in the 30s, but it was not very useful. It was in a very preliminary mode, and actually the first really the first electron microscope which had a strong impact in the field was done in 1954 in Oxford. Maybe you have heard the name Sir Peter Hirsch. He is still in Oxford, and as far as I know, he is still to some extent active, although he must be around 90. He built his own electron microscope in Oxford, in the materials science department. And one evening, he went into the room of his boss, who was also a sir. These were acquired sirs. Sir Neville Mott. Maybe you heard of Neville Mott. For example, the Mott transition is a phenomenon, and there are many, many other things. And he is one of the few Nobel laureates in our field. He went into the office of Sir Neville Mott, who was his boss, and said, "Sir, would you like to see a dislocation?" And that was the dawn of transmission electron microscopy applied in material science to such a huge extent as we see today. Now, of course, the discovery of this equipment, of this machine, of this wonderful machine, was a tremendous setback to line profile analysis, because until then, people were striving to develop line profile analysis because there was no other tool to see the defects really in quantitative manner. But from then onwards, everybody forgot about line profile analysis, which was actually producing so many problems, interpretation and measurement, etc. And there was this wonderful method where you could see what is in the material, until the uprising, the beginning of much better X-ray sources, X-ray diffractometers in the 80s, and the coming of the synchrotron. The synchrotron is, we know, a light source, a fantastic large-scale equipment, and they are growing like mushrooms all over the world. Today you can go, well, I don't know which is the closest one here. Perhaps you have one in India, I don't know. Do you have a synchrotron in India? Where? Yeah, but as far as I know, it is a relatively small one. Maybe in the next future, if the government and, of course, the scientific lobby can persuade the government to have a larger one, then maybe it will come up, because it is a fantastic equipment. You have here in Southeast Asia, you have quite a few synchrotrons. There are fantastic synchrotrons, I must tell you, in Taiwan. which is not very far from here. There is one in China, not too far from here, in Shanghai, and in Japan. So in Southeast Asia, there are also synchrotrons. And they are always open equipment where anybody can go who has a good idea and has to submit a proposal. The problem with the synchrotron is that the beam is so intensive and it is running 24 hours that within 4 or 5 days you can collect such a huge amount of data that you then, after that, you don't know what to do with them. You are thinking about the data evaluation and interpretation. You might even sit down and deal with them for years, not only months, but years. But a complete PhD can be based on 5 days beam time at the synchrotron if the measurement is really good. And that has sped up, line profile analysis has become, nowadays it is, I think, becoming more and more useful and used by many people. Okay, so after this not very informative introduction, let me go to the lecture. I have to start with this graph, which is again very old, 1965. Macherauch, he was a materials engineer in Germany, in Karlsruhe, which is one of the headquarters of material science. And he made, I think he was the first who made this very clear classification of internal stresses. If here we plot on the vertical axis the, let's say, the applied stress, sigma, to a material, to a structural material, then we have, first of all, an average stress, which is an average over the whole material. But then we have internal stresses, which are of three different categories. Sigma 1 is called, well, 1, 2, 3, first of all. But let's say class 1 or type 1 is the so-called macro stress. Macro stress is produced by the manufacturing process. For example, railway wheels have a very important macro stress which is introduced deliberately, and it was discovered, the casting procedure was discovered by a Swiss guy called Ganz. I'll show you this example. Ganz, this is a German name, this fellow came from Switzerland, apparently, well, not apparently, but accidentally, to Budapest, my place where I graduated, in the 1850s, when Switzerland was one of the poorest countries in Europe. It is hard to believe, but it was a very poor country. Many people migrated out. Ganz founded a foundry in Budapest, and he discovered that that was also the dawn when railway was built all over the world. He discovered that if the mold is of sand in the center and iron in the edges, then the edges will cool down faster than the center, and a strong compressive hoop stress will develop in the periphery of the railway wheel, and this is very advantageous. You see, this is the railway wheel, and in the outskirts there will be a compressive hoop stress. So if during the usage there are micro cracks in the surface, these hoop stress will heal these micro stresses. So this method is used today. This is a typical macro stress, because these hoop stresses act in regions of centimeters or tens to 100 millimeters, whereas the grain size is the grain size is not more than, let's say, 100 microns. So these stresses, these macro stresses, act over a large number of grains, okay, and they are introduced deliberately for a certain technical purpose. The second type of internal stress are the so-called lattice strains or stresses. I don't want to call them, they are called second order stresses, and they act between individual grains. So you can see that within the grain, the average stress can be higher or lower than the average. Okay? It can be higher or lower in individual grains. Now, this stress is a materials property. It has nothing to do with manufacturing. To some extent it does, but it is a materials property. Imagine that you have steel, okay? Normal alpha steel, BCC steel. Steel is known to be elastically anisotropic, which means that the moduli are very different in the different crystallographic orientations. For example, E100 or E110 or E111 in iron or iron alloys, iron-based alloys are very different. E100 is of the order of 60 gigapascal, whereas E111 is of the order of 180 gigapascal. A huge difference, a factor of 3. And if you strain that material, if you take a specimen and stress it, make a tensile deformation, then you can imagine that that the stress strain curve will be for the different grain orientations. For the hard grains with the large moduli, you will have this elastic part, but for the soft ones, you will have this one. And then they will work harden, like that. And if you stop here at some stage and unload them, and this will unload like that, and this will unload like that. And where is the equilibrium? When will you be able to take out your specimen from the tensile machine? At that moment, when the two stresses equal each other. You see, you come back from that total strain, you come back, and at this point, at this epsilon value, at this strain value, in the soft grains, you will have residual tensile stresses, and in the hard grains, you will have residual compressive stresses. Now, this will produce this second order stress, which is a materials property because it was produced by the elastic anisotropy of the material. Now the third kind of stress, residual stress, is drawn here like this zigzag, like this random zigzag, and that is the microstrain or microstress, which is produced by dislocations. Let's use the term dislocations without any, let's not be shy and use the term dislocations. The microstresses are, on the average, are zero within the grain, and they have a very specific role in the material properties. The microstresses produced by dislocations are, on the average, zero, simply because if you have lattice planes like that, this drawing you must have seen several times. It is, you can find it in the textbook. This is a dislocation. This is the dislocation line. Okay, you put in an extra lattice plane into your material with an edge, and this edge is the dislocation line. It is like when you want to split a chunk of wood with an axe. You put the axe into the chunk of wood and it splits, and there is a large stress and strain. And above this line, in this region, everything is compressed. The lattice constant is a little bit smaller than everywhere else. Whereas below this line, everything is pulled apart. So here the lattice constant is larger. So you have a compressive or compression zone, and you have a dilatation or a dilation zone. And these two zones cancel each other. They cancel to zero. So the net volume change produced by a dislocation is zero. Up to what? Is it really zero? Pardon? Pardon? And if you do a better measurement?
Then again limit.
Think of the following very simple thing. The binding force in a solid, the binding force in a solid, which we call the potential energy, looks like that. We learned that in school. You remember that graph?
The Lagrange's potential.
Yes.
Potential.
Yes, the cohesive potential. Okay? Now, at zero Kelvin, this will be the equilibrium position. At higher temperature, you go here, and at the half point, it will be a little bit higher. What is this? How do you call that phenomenon? Thermal?
Expansion.
Thermal expansion. And what kind of a phenomenon are we seeing here? This we call unharmonicity. Because here at the bottom it is somewhat harmonic. The potential energy is somewhat harmonic, but at higher temperatures it becomes unharmonic. It becomes asymmetric. And this is the reason, this is the only reason for thermal expansion, unharmonicity. Now, come back to the dislocation. What is easier, to press the atoms together or to pull them apart?
Pull them
apart. So what will happen if you have a lot of dislocations? what will the volume do in terms of the unharmonicity? Pardon? Volume will increase, okay? But only to second order. So in the first order, if you have not too many dislocations, you will not be able to measure this effect because it will be too small. But if you have a large number of dislocations, you might be able to measure that. But if you have so many dislocations, then the whole material is completely disturbed. So it is not easy to measure it, but it can be. So up to the first order, dislocations do not change the volume or do not change the lattice constant. But in the second order, due to unharmonicity, the lattice volume or the material's volume is increasing and the lattice constant is increasing. Anyhow, in this graph, sigma 3, the microstress, is showing as an average zero around this value, okay? Around the value of sigma 2. Okay. Now, this is just in words what I told you before, so we can skip that. Sometimes the second order internal stress is called intergranular stress because it is between grains, individual grains, and they are actually defined in terms of the averaging. The macro stress is averaged, as we said, over many grains. It is a macro stress. Of course, it has to be balanced in the unstressed state. In the railway wheel, if there is a compressive hoop stress, this will be compensated to zero in the internal part of the wheel by counteracting hoop stress. So at the end, the average stress will be zero because the rail doesn't start running away by itself. And the micro strains or micro stresses are produced by dislocations, solely by dislocations.
So if there is substitution atoms, or
yes.
Yes.
Yes, but they will change the lattice constant. And their strain field is short range, whereas the strain field of dislocations is long range. So you will not be able to see the strain of point defects in the same sense as the strain or stress produced by dislocations. Point defects, as I will show you, do not make line broadening. They make a diffuse scattering below the Bragg reflections, a slowly varying diffuse scattering, because the strain field is short range. We'll come back to that in more specifically. So macro stresses produce a peak shift, and that is the way to measure them. Engineers are very eager to measure internal stresses. And you can use any diffraction line, but it turns out that the largest effect is in the back reflection mode. So therefore, for example, residual internal stresses or macro stresses are most often interested in steel. Steel is our fundamental structural material, and it turns out that a diffraction peak of the chromium K alpha is almost at 180 degrees 2 theta. Therefore, many equipment dedicated to measure internal stresses in steel specimens operate with a chromium tube, chromium K alpha, which has a wavelength of about 2.3 angstrom, actually very long. It is a very soft X-ray, and therefore the penetration depth is very small. And if this is our specimen, and this is the incoming beam, then it is the residual stress is measured in this angular region, in this close to 180 degrees 2 theta. This is the dedicated equipment are made with that, chromium. I must tell you, chromium is not a very good radiation because of its so long wavelength. First of all, air absorption is very strong at this wavelength. So you have to use very short distances, otherwise your intensity goes to zero. And the penetration depth, as I mentioned, is very low. The intergranular stresses can be measured recently very well, newly. What I show you here is this so-called lattice strain measurement, which was done by neutron diffraction. Now, during the last 20 years, a very smart technique has been developed at spallation neutron sources. And this is a measurement which was done at one of these diffractometers. Spallation neutron source, well, the lecture title given also in your program says X-ray line profile analysis. Actually, it would be more precise to say line profile analysis, diffraction line profile analysis, because today I would say that neutrons are just as has the same right to be included as X-rays. Although neutrons are more expensive, no doubt, but more and more spallation sources are coming up. A new one is being built in Europe, and there are two in the United States, one in Japan. There is one being built in southern China, close to Hong Kong, and there is one in England, and a new one is being built in Europe, which will be probably one of the best, because whenever a new such large-scale equipment is built, then the people try to surpass the older ones. Spallation neutron source, let me tell you two words about it. You take a heavy element. Now people take mercury. You take fast positrons or positrons or not positrons, fast hydrogen atoms, that is the it is an ion beam, okay? Ion beam, high energy ion beam. You bombard that, there is an accelerator, a linear accelerator, a very strong, very large one. It is half a kilometer long. This is a target mercury. Why mercury? Because it is liquid and you have to cool it. Because if you shoot here a few MeV with a large current, then it will, first of all, you split the atoms, and when the atom is split, it is emitting a lot of neutrons. And these neutrons, so there is a spallation. Spallation means it is split up. And a lot of neutrons are coming out. And these neutrons are then channeled into a so-called beam line. And this is an equipment. Now, one of the large advantage of this kind of nuclear source, neutron source, is that you can switch it off. Because if the ion beam is switched off, then the whole process doesn't work. So it is not like a nuclear reactor, which can also be used as a neutron source, but a nuclear reactor cannot be switched off like that. So if the green people are going to the street to protest against a nuclear reactor, they cannot protest against this one. So this can be built anywhere because it has absolutely no harm to the environment. Of course, it has other advantages and, of course, disadvantages. The ion beam, can be pulsed. And then the neutron source becomes a pulsed neutron source. And pulsed sources have great advantage because they can give you time-resolved experiments. Now, since you get here a neutron impulse, pulsed, the neutron intensity is like that, coming out, number of neutrons in a certain frequency. You can set your watch at 0 second and measure how long it takes to the neutron to get into the detector. And that makes it easy to use the so-called time of flight method, which is actually an energy dispersive method. You don't have to scan your detector around the specimen, but you put your detector somewhere at a fixed position, and you only care about the time which the neutron takes from the source to the detector. And that gives you the time of flight is proportional to its speed, and its speed is proportional to the energy. So if you know the energy, then of course you know the wavelength. So it is an energy dispersive method. And what people do is, I want you to understand this graph. What people do is they take a neutron beam, this pulsed neutron beam, they take a specimen, put it at 45 degrees to the beam, and they put one detector here at 90 degrees and one detector on the other side also at 90 degrees. Now look, the two detectors measure two fundamentally different things. Because in the right-hand detector, the diffraction vector is always the angular, is the half-angular vector. This is your diffraction vector on the right-hand side, okay? Which means that you are observing these lattice planes, okay? Whereas in the other detector, your diffraction vector is this, and you are measuring these lattice planes. So this is G left in this graph. You see? Now, if you pull this specimen like this, and you can do in situ measurement, then in this left-hand side detector, if I draw that specimen like this, I enlarge it to show more. I just put it here enlarged. Then the different grains with different crystallographic orientation in the stress direction, let's say this is 111, this is 200, this is 311, this is 220, then the 111 reflection in this pattern, which is produced by this, which is in this detector, the 111 peak will be produced by those grains or those grains which have the crystallographic orientation parallel to that stress axis 111. So a certain HKL group of grains is selected out in each peak. So the different peaks are not averages of all differently oriented grains, but are specifically produced by one orientation group of grains. So they are selective for one HKL direction. And this is what you see here. You see here that the 111 grains have the largest Young's modulus, because the first part of this curve is linear within experimental error. So the slope of this black line gives you the Young's modulus in the 111 direction. The brown one gives you the first slope, gives you the elastic constant of the 100 direction. So this method gives you the possibility to measure the orientation-dependent moduli in a polycrystal, which was not possible before. I think it is a beautiful method. And it is called lattice strain. Of course, it gives you much more than just the elastic anisotropy of a polycrystal immediately, because what you see here is that at a certain point, there is a turn in the graph, which means that in that grain family, oriented with a certain HKL relative to the stress, work hardening has started. And look, work hardening is very different in the different grain groups. So it gives you a tremendous insight into how and to by what procedure work hardening is proceeding in a polycrystalline material. That corresponds to, that is also part of line profile analysis. It is not the shape, but the position of the peaks. Well, let's come now to line broad. Yes. Yes.
Initially, they can be oriented anywhere.
Of course, they are not at the same place. They are different at different places in the material.
So your sigma to intergranular strain is also, we should not look at it as, like, I'm trying to look at it in a spatial way, right? Like your macro stresses throughout the sample, right? At a pulp.
Yes. Scale. These are not the microstrains,
so
the intergranular.
Intergranular.
Yes.
When you say intergranular, then the two grains, so you mean like different orientations have different. But what I'm getting over here is more of an average
strain. Yes, of course you get an average. An average, absolutely an average. So you don't see how the individual grains interact with each other. You don't know anything about the position of the grains, but you get an overall average of the intergranular stresses, strains and stresses. And that is what was, what, well, it can be done also at a synchrotron. So in that sense, it is not the privilege of this neutron diffraction method, but at a synchrotron it is not so easy. I must tell you, it is not so easy because at the synchrotron, to get through the specimen, you have to get through the specimen. To get through the specimen, you need high energies. Let's say at least 50 kV, 50 kilo electron volt. Now, at this high energy, you can calculate easily the wavelength. The wavelength is in the below in the tenth or hundreds of angstroms, which means that your diffraction angles become your diffraction angles will be within 10 degrees. Okay, and there in this small angular range, actually the accuracy of the peak position becomes very bad, whereas With this experiment, the peak position can be measured with a very high precision easily. So it is a very convenient way to measure that. Now, this arrangement was discovered or first done in Los Alamos, where they have a spallation source. It was developed at the Los Alamos Material Science Beamline. And since then, you have the same arrangement in England, in Oak Ridge, in Japan, and of course, you will have it in the European spallation source also, because it is so effective and so powerful.
The left, whatever you are getting is from the left detector. So what is the?
This is from the left detector. You can get an average from the right-hand detector. It tells you a different aspect, okay? Because your grains for the right-hand detector, these grains can be rotated randomly, and then consists of contribution from very different oriented grains. So in the right-hand detector, you don't get the same information, only in the left-hand one. So there, a very good question, thank you. So that shows that the two detectors are not identical. Yeah? Yeah?
Left-hand detector, suppose you will be getting a diffraction pattern, correct?
Yes.
Diffraction pattern, and I think then analyzing the same, each and individual peaks for the different planes, and then you will be trying to evaluate them, like what are the stresses involved, that's it?
That's right. Each peak will be shifted,
yeah.
but the shifts are shown here in this graph. Actually, when you say, this is the applied stress, and when you say lattice strain, that is the peak shift. Actually, what we know, this epsilon equal minus cotangens theta delta theta. That's so simple. Well, and now come to line broadening. We still have half an hour, or if anybody has questions, please interrupt me, just as so far. So the microstrains or stresses, they are produced by dislocations, and the peaks broaden. And now we want to go into peak broadening.
Same sort of experiments which you told about the neutron diffraction can we do using X-ray sources?
Well, in a laboratory experiment, you could do it. And you have to think about how to do it. It is not easy. It's not easy. You have to go through the material. You see, in a well, the other condition for this experiment was that it was done in situ. You have to do it in situ. Okay? You have to stress the specimen because otherwise you don't see this evolution. So if you want to do it in the in an X-ray experiment, you also have to stress your specimen and you have to go through. So in a laboratory equipment, then you would need a very thin specimen. With a micro tensile machine, it is conceivable that you can do it, but then you start getting surface effects and things like that, so it is not trivial. Better to apply beam for a beamline at one of these beams. Okay. Well, line broadening, I start my lecture by saying that line broadening is small. This expression I learned from one of my teachers, whom I will cite and mention several times, the late Wilkens. I will come back to his name a few times. And he was one who contributed to up-to-date file analysis, probably the most, together with also the late Krivoglas. Krivoglas and Wilkens, they have built up that kind of line profile analysis which today is used by many people. So look at that graph. It is taken from the literature. This is the Trento group. Nickel ball milled for 12 hours. It is certainly very strongly deformed, and the dislocation density is whatever you can pump into a material. But still, the peaks are narrow. Look at these narrow peaks, especially in the forward diffraction. In the backward region here, of course, you see the broadening. Although, even on this peak, you can faintly see the K alpha doublet effect. It is slightly asymmetric on the right hand side. You see, it has a shoulder. If you look carefully, it has a shoulder, which is the K alpha 2. The logarithmic plot shows you that in the tail region, where the density is very low, there is a very strong overlap. So the peak broadening goes down into the background. It merges into the background. And that is one of the major problems in experiment, that you want to have the tail region of something which is disturbed and perturbed by the background. Background is an enemy of line profile analysis. The same from the Budapest group, aluminium 3% magnesium. This 3% is well beyond the solubility, but by mechanical alloying you can get all the magnesium into solid solution in aluminum, and there are no traces of the magnesium peaks in this pattern, not even in the logarithmic scale. And you see, again, a similar overlap. You see, even the 200 and 220 are strongly overlapping because the tail region is broadening. Well, this is magnesium. Magnesium is an ungrateful material for line profile analysis, because it is impossible to get too many dislocations in magnesium, because it is a low melting alloy, or material, low melting point material, with a very large grain size. You cannot get down the grain size of magnesium. And whatever dislocations you pump into it, they can anneal it, anneal out very easily, even at room temperature. And this was an experiment done at a neutron source. It was maybe not. No, I'm wrong. That was not a neutron. This is X-ray diffraction. It was done by this guy Figueiro. Now he is in, I think he is in Brazil. But you see that again, you have broadening only in the high angle peaks, and you do have some differences which are not negligible. And this is probably because of twinning, which I'm not sure if it has been taken into account here. Magnesium tends to twin.
Sir, what is the JK60?
Pardon?
Sir, JK60.
It is a magnesium alloy which contains aluminium and silicon. You would have to look up into that paper. You have the exact composition here. You will have the PDF file. And this is a very frequently used commercial alloy of magnesium. This is aluminium base, aluminium magnesium. This is the neutron diffraction experiment, which was done by this Korean colleague, who is now in Korea, working at an experimental reactor, so at a nuclear reactor, which is the neutron source. And he has a material science beamline there. If you want to do an experiment with neutrons, you can apply to him. And this was friction stir welding in situ. A pretty crazy idea, I must say. This is the weld cross-section. And measurements were taken at these points. And you see that in the central part, it is totally like a homogenized nanocrystalline material because it was heated and deformed. So in the center, there were no dislocations. You could see some dislocations far from the weld zone, which you can see here in this logarithmic plot. Red is at zero, which is somewhat narrower, and black is at 25 millimeters from the zone, from the welded zone, and you see some line broadening. It is small, very small. Neutron diffraction has many very exotic properties and very interesting, but the problem with neutrons is that the beam is always large. You cannot, neutrons are neutral, so there is no way to focus them down to a small size. X-rays can be focused very well. You can make a nice small beam at a synchrotron. You can go down to beam size below 1 micron today. Neutron beam is at the best 2 millimeter in diameter, but that is very small for a neutron beam. The instrumental effect can be measured and can be small and can be corrected. So let me show you a synchrotron experiment on a true powder diffraction experiment where the instrumental effect was measured on lanthanum hexaboride. Lanthanum hexaboride is a very good standard material because it has many peaks. Not like silicon. Silicon has only few peaks, so there are gaps between the peaks. Whereas lanthanum hexaboride has a large number of peaks, which are very narrow because it is a an ionic crystal, and you can anneal it, and the grain size can be made a few microns. So above one micron, I will come back to that, above one micron there is absolutely no grain size effect. If the grain size is 1 micron or larger, 2 microns, then it is, for X-rays, it is as a perfect crystal. And the dislocations can be annealed out. This is lead sulfide, which we call galena. It was grinded for 12 hours in a ball mill. And this is the pattern measured in a synchrotron. You can go up to very high indices. And if you compare the peaks, you see how nicely the tail region was measured out. You see the long tail. And in the center, you see the instrumental effect. So the instrumental effect is nicely much, much smaller than the effect of grinding on galena. This was an interesting project, ball milling of galena. And the patterns were compared to ancient Egyptian galena specimens, which were used for eye makeup, which is used today in India. Galena, lead sulfide, has a beautiful black color. And it is even used today. Ladies, do you know of galena? You know of galena?
Galena.
Lead sulfide.
Lead sulfide.
Yes, it is used in eye makeup.
In
India, even today, as far as I know. No? And the idea was to find out how the ancient Egyptians made their makeup. Actually, there are not so many sources of lead sulfide. One of the largest largest founds are in India, as far as I know. So you know about that.
No. Almost like we might be using without knowing what it is exactly.
Well, ask the vendor what he was putting in to the eye makeup. It has a beautiful black color. And the Egyptians mixed it with calcium oxide, which is white like that, so they could produce the grayscale from white to black. Okay, so X-ray diffraction peaks can be shifted, can broaden, can become asymmetric, and the combination of any of these. I show you an old example. Pardon? Yes? You will have the PDF file, so don't worry. This is a very old example from 1984-86. Copper single crystals were tensile deformed to these values. In the center, you see the peak profile of, and these are all O2 reflections of a single crystal, tensile deformed. It is a logarithmic scale. So the full width at half maximum is at intensity 0.5, which is somewhere here. Okay? This is about 0.5. And if you go here, you see that the undeformed virgin crystal has a breadth which is some more than 20 times smaller than the largest. This measurement was done on a dedicated high-resolution double crystal diffractometer with negligible instrumental effect. So the instrument does not need to be corrected. It is easy to understand why. Let me explain that in one word. A perfect single crystal diffraction, we are talking about kinematical scattering. We are in the kinematical scattering regime. But perfect large single crystals do behave differently. The diffraction has to be described by the dynamical scattering theory because the scattering is dynamic. Now, in a dynamic scattering regime, this is 2 theta, this is the intensity. The diffraction peak in reflection will have the following shape. Theoretically, it will have this shape, where this is 1. That means that it is total reflection. Okay, all the incoming beam is reflected. In reality, it is a little bit damped and has a slanting top, but it is almost total reflection, almost 95%. And this breadth depends on the HKL and the wavelength. And it is called Darwin breadth. Darwin breadth. And the exact breadth position is not here, but is here. Okay? And this phenomenon can be derived with exact mathematics, either using the Schrödinger equation, where you have particles, or by the Maxwell equations, where you have waves. And the results are identical, because the starting equations, the wave equation, in the two approaches are identical. The mathematics is identical. Now, dynamical scattering is naturally occurring and observed in electron microscopy. In X-rays, and especially neutrons, it is not. Because to have dynamical effects, the so-called extinction length, that means the length which the wave has to travel on the average to be diffracted, is very different for electrons, X-rays, and neutrons. For electrons, the extinction length is in the order of a few nanometers, let's say 10 nanometers, but the specimens are also of the same order of magnitude. The thickness of your specimen in the electron microscope is a little bit larger, let's say 10 nanometers. It can be, maybe it is, so for electrons, the extinction length is between 1 and 10 nanometers, because the interaction is strong. For X-rays, the extinction length, so the length which the wave has to travel to be reflected, is something like a micron. And for neutrons, it is something like millimeters. This is because of the interaction. It's so different. Neutrons interact like billiard balls. They are knocked on the nucleus, unless you are concerned with magnetic interaction. Now, in in a TEM, your specimen is larger than the extinction length. In X-rays, your crystals in a powder specimen are usually not much larger than the extinction length. That means that when an X-ray comes in to your specimen, once it is scattered, it leaves the grain. Okay? So you automatically come into the kinematical scattering regime. Scattering is only once. You have single scattering. For dynamical scattering, you need multiple scattering of the same wave back and forth. And when you are deep in the crystal, you don't know which is the incoming beam and which is the reflected beam. Now, for copper, before I go to one more idea, more thought, in copper, the Darwin breadth, delta Darwin, is 19 arc seconds for the 2-0 reflection. And this virgin crystal breadth here at the top was measured 21 seconds of arc. Okay? So the instrumental effect was practically zero. Because you cannot go below the Darwin breadth by any means in a reflection experiment. One more thought before I continue to the dynamical. If you have a large crystal, large perfect crystal with the lattice plane like this, and your beam is coming in, which is never infinitely narrow, then the beam is scattered. Many times, and at the end, here, you don't know which was incoming, which was reflected. The energy is traveling down, parallel to the lattice planes. That is dynamical effect. That never happens if the crystal is small compared to the extinction length. Compared to these zigzag lengths. Well, this is a very hand-waving way of explaining it, but the quintessence is something like that.
At each point, if the stress has been considered.
Pardon?
At each point, if the stress has been considered as when we are doing the tensile testing.
Again, your question?
When we are doing the tensile testing,
yes.
So the stress distribution is different at different portion of the sample?
No. The stress is homogeneous.
A stress?
It's a single crystal.
So it's a single crystal.
So at which point we are considering here for the single crystal?
At any point. The beam is large. It is about 1 millimeter times 0.2 millimeters, relatively large beam, and the microstructure is more or less homogeneous. Okay, you take a long single crystal rod, you tensile deform it, everywhere you have more or less the same microstructure.
So local effects we are avoiding.
There are there are local effects, but this was not the case when we didn't care about that.
An average analysis.
Yes, but these are average peak profiles. Now, I will go through that slide and then we can make a break. Okay? So, you have broadening, okay? Which is caused by dislocations. You have an asymmetry. Look, this tail is much faster dropping than on the right-hand side. And you have a shift of the peak. Now, if you look at theta, look, theta is going in the left-hand direction, okay? So, if this would be an unharmonic effect, that means you pump in a lot of dislocations, so the lattice constant should, we discussed that, increase. In which direction should the shift be? Two? Two? That was a good answer. Lower angle. Which is the lower angle direction? No. You can't see the bottom? Can you see the bottom? There is theta. So this is not conventionally drawn, this graph. Lower angle is to the right. So what is the lattice constant doing? Decreasing. So what's happening? Of course, afterwards you can always be much smarter. What happens is that during plastic deformation, only a very small fraction of the dislocations remain in the material. You must know that. Okay, most of the dislocations annihilate each other. Okay? That is well known. Okay? Take it as granted. We can discuss that later if you want, but only a very small fraction of dislocations remains in the material after plastic this was a large plastic deformation. Most of the dislocation, 95%, annihilate. Work hardening is done by those which remain. Most of them disappear. Now, annihilation can occur in two different ways. Either this is a dislocation with this is the extra lattice plane. Okay? So if two dislocations come very close to each other, then they annihilate and there are vacancies. They produce a large number of vacancies. If the two dislocations meet in this configuration, then you will introduce here a lot of interstitials. So one is vacancy type annihilation, the other one is interstitial type annihilation. Now, to produce interstitials, in copper, the activation energy for interstitials is about 2 electron volts. For vacancies, it is about 1 electron volt. This factor of 2 in the Boltzmann factor, which we learn in school, is an astronomical number. So that means that the interstitial type of annihilation we can forget about. Okay? So annihilation proceeds with this process. Okay? Or the interstitials are just disappearing. Now, if you have interstitials we relax a little bit. So vacancies, if you have a large vacancy concentration in your material, in your metal or whatever, it can be ionic crystal, large vacancy concentration means as if you have alloyed into it an atom which has a smaller size. So what will be the effect? Decrease of the lattice constant. So this finally might give you a possibility to make a guess or an approximate evaluation of vacancy concentration in the material. And this you can compare with the number of dislocations which have annihilated. Okay. I don't know what is next.
Is there any method where we can evaluate the vacancy concentration?
Yes. You can do it. We have done that a few times, and I can give you references. Okay. I think this is just a list of things. So peak shifts, internal stresses, of course we have seen, okay, in the lattice strain measurement, peak shift is when you in situ strain, stacking faults, chemical inhomogeneities. Vacancies are not listed here, but they are there. Broadening, microstrains. Of course, if you have very small grain size or subgrain size, that will give you size broadening. Subgrains, small crystallites, asymmetries, internal stress. I didn't talk about the internal stresses related to the asymmetric diffraction peak. I may not come to that point. We'll see. And I think, well, and let's continue with this one. We want to separate the different effects. We want to separate out how much are the dislocations, how much are the twins, how much are the stacking faults, what is the effect of chemistry, etc. And the chance to do that is given here. The order dependence of the HKL reflections, if you have many peaks, the different effects affect the different HKL peaks in a different manner. So if you can exploit, if you can work out the differences in the different HKL peaks, the effects on the different HKL peaks, you have a chance to separate out the different effects. HKL anisotropy, profile shape is also a factor, and especially for planar defects, you have subprofiles which can be displaced and broadened in a different. So that is that gives you a large variety of effects, which is again HKL dependent. And I would suggest we continue from here after a break. Thank you.